Welcome everyone to High Performance Computing, Advanced Scientific Computing, our lecture one today. The part of this lecture is really to get an overview, and the idea is to really think about what topics are actually related to high performance computing, what is high performance computing, and also how it relates to supercomputing. These are all different terminologies, and there are lots of different terminologies that we will learn throughout the course more in detail, while this course really today introduces a little bit about the terminologies of shared memory, distributed memory, a multi-core chip, a many-core chip, which some already know from the GPUs that you have in gaming that are now also used for scientific computing. So in a way, really an overview lecture. But here and there we go into details and also will, of course, explore a lot of aspects which are related to the HPC ecosystem. We will look at scientific visualizations, why they play a key role in high performance computing. But before we go into the material in this lecture, let us review what we had the last time. So in the practical lecture 01, we had our two working horses in the course, which are the deep test cluster over here. And also we have this Icelandic system that we use here in the course, Jotun, for really programming a couple of MPI applications and shared memory systems. So however, both systems are different, of course, from the design, from the system architecture. And today we will basically see these ingredients of the system architectures. However, they have one commonality. And what we learned is that really both systems are driven by a Unix operating system. This could be in HPC systems, various derivates in a way from Unix. There are some which, for instance, use CentOS. Others have a very, let's say, dedicated operating system that we have seen, for instance, on IBM systems in the past. However, the key message is once you learn Unix, once you understand Unix and have, let's say, a couple of commands really at your disposal, you really can operate these different machines no matter if it is now a deep test cluster, the Jotun, or the supercomputers in Jülich, the Jewel system or the Jureka system, or even systems in China and systems in the US. Because there's one commonality really in the area of HPC, and that the systems usually are kind of basically running with a derivative in a Unix way. And we have explored several of these interesting commands the last time. And this was, for instance, hostname. Here an example, minus A, that gives you the fully qualified host name, where we have seen that this deep test cluster in real has a complete different host name. And also we understood that once we logged into such a system, we can actually always see with host name, with this interesting command, where we are. And of course it matters if, let's say, you would have five HPC systems you work with. And here you see clearly that although it's the same command and a different, let's say, system, of course, it gives you then the same modus operandi in all of these different, let's say, different commands we had the last time. We had who am I, clear, we used the VI editor to actually also edit documents, and you can be sure that usually the VI would be on all the most systems. However, there's one specific command I would like to highlight, which is now also basically related to this, and it's used in the HPC arena very often. It's a module environment, which is a HPC ecosystem environment we learned the last time as well. And we looked at basically all the different libraries, or let's say helper libraries that we want to use. Python was just one example. We learned that scikit-learn is there, for instance, as an example for machine learning. There are different versions of MPI, which is important. There are different CUDA versions, or CUDA is a library for GPUs. And you see different Jupyter kernels here for different areas of, you know, using the Jupyter lab and the Jupyter notebook. So this is a very interesting, flexible way of really organizing all your different libraries you have. Down from the very, let's say, bottom is having, you know, CMake, really little helper files, up to really sophisticating tools we use today, like PyTorch, for example, here for GPUs for cutting edge deep learning. And you basically can see with module avail, which modules are on the systems. And when you want to load a particular system, you usually use module load. In more, let's say, next lectures, in the practical lectures, when we dive more deeper in HPC, when we know the basics, when we have a fundament to stand on, then we will also learn that essentially we will use different modules. We will combine modules and we will have them in so-called job scripts that the scheduler will understand. But these are all topics we will then see how that materializes when we come to the practical lecture 1.1, where we'll then also share more light on the practicalities of a HPC system. However, the last time we also had the way how to access such systems. And this is in many ways then one, of course, different. There you could have lots of different possibilities, but one that basically has a kind of commonality is again the SSH, the secure shell. And this is not just basically having so-called SSH keys. If you remember the last time we said some of the systems that really require you to create a public-private key pair. Some refer them to SSH, but it's a whole protocol also that you can use, let's say, also without the keys to access a system. And we have basically seen this in a demonstration that when you have a private-public key pair, all you basically usually have to do is to upload your public key pair to the system once, and this will be known there. And every time you want to connect then, basically with your host, with your laptop, with your system, you basically have to use your matching private key that is really then checked with the public key if it's a matching one in order to get an access to the system, a so-called basically instance of this SSH connection where you then can really work. And it can execute, for instance, these Unix commands we just learned from. However, they're kind of two ingredients and partly also another one that depends really on the system. So the first ingredient to have this is to have a host name, a remote host. You will connect to another system, so you need the name of the system. Equally, like you type in Google, basically, or in the browser, then a Google, www.google.de or something like this. You will have a host name. So what is basically the address of the system, which of course indirectly means a certain IP address. Here, for an example, we had the deep.fz-jülich.de. But of course, equally, we have seen we can use utun.rhoi.rhoi.is to connect to this system. Then, of course, you would have specific usernames on these systems. So basically, while here we have seen through deep, I connect with my readel1 identity, which is really specific, and everybody of you in the course gets a different identity to really differentiate between different users. These are the two key ingredients that you really need definitively to connect via SSH. We have seen an SSH client might be handy, something like MobileXTerm that you have here as an example, but you can use PuTTY if you want, or some of the Mac users or Linux derivatives of Unix, they would have an SSH client usually already installed. So you can just type in the command line, for instance, SSH username at remote host. And then you basically are already there. However, there's one now specific part of it. You can imagine there must be some security. So who is allowed to access the systems and how I prove that I'm really myself. And there are different ways of doing this. Of course, one we basically allude to before already and last time was this private public key. So I have the private key on my laptop, which is kind of then the third ingredient in some occasions that you have to give then also as an input to this request of establishing this SSH connection. Now, by having this private key, you of course should never ever basically copy that to another system. So don't put it on another HPC system to jump to another HPC system. So this is something what you shouldn't do. The private key should always remain on your laptop or machine where you created it. Now, the interesting thing is that some of the systems, like for instance, our, let's say, teaching cluster is a little bit more, let's say, open in the sense that we don't have SSH keys. We just have a, username and password. However, it's kind of indirectly also protected because we have it, let's say, not really in an open network. We have it as part of the university network only accessible. So that means you need a VPN channel, or for those that cannot have one, basically here in the course, I told you that we basically can make a jump here to Hekla, which is another system which is open via SSH. And then from there, you can have, your kind of SSH username at YouTune, and then you basically can access YouTune. And that's really all what we learned. Of course, there are lots of smaller details. You see the interesting welcome screen, which has some meaning in HPC. It's always something which usually tells you the high messages, the important messages of the system. What's happening? Is the file system down? Do we have some certain quota of files? What is the situation of the system? So there are lots of different examples. But let us come now to basically the right real lecture today, which is a bit basically conceptual, of course, but also really introducing this topic from a more broad sense, and also going and to basically introduce a couple of terminologies which really will come back to us again and again in the course, like MPI, the message passing interface, is very important, or shared memory with OpenMP, accelerators with GPUs. All of those would be a little bit introduced in this lecture. And the idea of the outline of the lecture is really to learn some basics. And this means that you don't not only basically understand the four basic building blocks that we have in HPC, but also the relevance maybe of scientific visualizations, why we call them supercomputers, why I benchmark so important to really understand basically, do we have a very fast system? Then there's really this idea of the whole course where you think about more and more, we're not anymore in serial programming, not in serial computing. It takes some time to understand that we basically have multi-core CPUs and also multiple CPUs in parallel to basically then perform parallel programming. And this relates to how we program these systems. So we have shared memory where the access to memory is quite easy. But also, if you then suddenly go across CPUs, across GPUs, and then basically across whole nodes in the HPC system, we see that that's not all that easy anymore. So we have to think about that parts of this is really distributed memory. So just accessing the memory as we used to as variables when we program is not possible anymore. We have to think about message passing of really getting, you know, messages from one memory space to another. And then, of course, you can imagine that people have thought about really combining these techniques, where we'll talk a little bit about hybrid architectures and programming, although there will be a more elaborate lecture coming up. Then in the second part of the lecture today, we will really think about the broader picture. So when we have introduced this kind of basic terminology, what is surrounding this? So we have basically lots of terminologies we will look to, monitoring systems. We will have then a little bit the view and the advent of many core GPUs. So they are really, let's say, more recent in high performance computing. So we elaborate on this and also will think about the relationships to AI, which is important, and look more and more on system architectures, terminology, what is a rack, what is a blade. And also a little bit underneath all of this is really the idea that this HPC ecosystem is always changing. It's cutting edge technology. And actually, it's also sometimes just, you know, basically obsolete. It's not anymore cutting edge. So people either stop complete series of HPC systems, like we have seen in the IBM Blue Gene series, or basically we have complete new designs where maybe the supercomputing is really driven by a co-design of applications. That's what we will come back to when we think about deepest. And then we quickly come also to an interesting aspect that the data access today is maybe much more important than we had in the past. So we would in the past say more computing is needed. Today we think much more about how we can increase the data access to these cores, to these GPUs. So the data throughput is much more a challenge today for these systems. We've seen some examples of, you know, machine and deep learning and how basically big data is driving this advent of basically new HPC systems, which are a bit more modular. So really to have not only physics simulations simulated and computed, but also let's say methods of AI. And we basically end this lecture today a little bit with kind of related topics. While this course, of course, is not completely giving lights on all of these interesting topics, which means really large scale infrastructures, there's PRAISE, there's XSEED, let's say HPC driven infrastructures, which really offer HPC systems, large-scale HPC systems on different sites in Europe and the US, just as an example. And of course, we end a little bit with an outlook to quantum computing. While people were saying quantum computing is something of the very future, we already start using it. We had already some papers on it. And basically, this is, of course, reflecting just a car part of quantum computing, which is quantum annealing. But still, it shows you that quantum computing is not something, a dream of the future. You can actually buy already systems like D-Wave systems and actually work on them. Of course, it's the baby steps we do all in the world together to really drive quantum computing. But we will see there that this has been a huge impact in HPC in the next 5 to 10 years. So let's see a little bit on the learning outcomes. It's really thinking about the latest developments on the one hand, and also carry the essence of high performance computing. Also here and there going really far in the past. So what happened 10 years ago? You know, BlueJeans systems from IBM, there's a different series style, the P, the Q, and suddenly obsolete. So we will learn basically the idea of how to create those high performance clusters. What are the key ingredients? We need a network, a very good network. We need high performance chips, so probably multi-core chips with a high single thread performance. But we have seen that, interestingly enough, also GPUs, which are much more many-core, let's say more moderate performance on all these chips, basically can have a huge impact because they have just many of this basically core chips, and in the hundreds and thousands these days. And that's why we basically learn a little bit of this. Orthogonal to all of this, in a way, is also the complex aspects of parallel programming, particularly in this lecture, to thinking about shared memory have different threads in parallel. MPI has different processes in parallel. How can I program that? Of course, this will be then substance also of the whole course. So it's just an introduction here, of course, to all what we will learn in the next weeks. So the basics really start with what means high performance computing. And if you go to the community, we would always say directly, hey, performance computing has a very close relationship to a supercomputer. And when you do this every now and then and Google it, you will see you'll be directly redirected, where you say a supercomputer is at the basically compute at the front line of contemporary processing capacity. And here particularly the speed of calculation. So this refers to high performance. And we will come to this in the performance and the benchmarks in a moment. But usually these are really intertwined, and you will find basically that all the supercomputers in the world are HPC machines. So, and if you look about what's really driving this, also the community, why there's a large, let's say, community in HPC and many people using HPC today in practice, you see it has kind of four building blocks, which relates to different aspects also that we will have again and again in the course. There's some theory to it. So physical laws, numerical methods, which are used really to compute simulations of physics. There's this idea of having more and more computing power, then I really can speed up my calculation. So I don't need to have 1 week of just computing a weather forecast. I want to have it in a couple of hours. This is achieved by using parallel computing. For this, I need good technology that is actually able to cope with parallelization, which means we have multi-core, of course, but also much more cores together, put together with a network. And then, of course, you compute a lot with very good supercomputers. That means you have storage requirements. What to do with a simulation you computed? You want to drop it to disk to get more insights, to analyze it, to perform post-processing. So all of this is basically then ideas where the communities have different solutions, where they work on, where they use HPC. And this was driving, and more recently also in the co-designer idea, really together with the applications, the architectures. While we have, let's say, traditional wordings for this, partly shared memory, distributed memory, we see that many of these systems today, of course, are hybrid. Many of these systems today have really an emphasis of interconnects, which are important. But we will also learn in modular supercomputing later on. An aspect of making it usable for the users, of course, is the idea of software. So if you really have just hardware in a way where really some actually do still have assembler and so on, which is of course very rare to program the systems, more and more libraries are there. Libraries are ported from traditional CPUs to GPUs these days. We have a whole ecosystem software environment to monitor the HPC environment or the system, how many cores are maybe basically overheated or basically not working. We have schedulers to really share the system with different users. You schedule your job on these big systems here, and basically the scheduler decides where exactly is it on the system and make sure it don't really interfere with running systems from other users. Now, with this again, just as a reminder, really think about that HPC is in this realm. We had this already a little bit in the prologue and also in the practical lecture, that basically we focus in this course much more on this HPC, which really brings an emphasis on this network interconnection, so that really this core work in parallel together to solve one problem. You could say that HTC is doing similar things. They also use parallel computing, but they don't interact so frequently between each other. And this will be a common idea of HPC applications with weather forecasts, for example, when you have numerical weathers or wave propagation through the ocean. These are all things where HPC really matter. When you just want to have word counts and documents about sports, politics, then you can use this with HTC. There's no point of in between really summarize. You maybe just at the end want to summarize. And our complementary cloud computing and big data course is really working on this much more. So here we have HPC, and the common idea of using parallel computing is really to solve some compute intensive problem with a lot of cores in a cooperative way. So you would have always these different CPUs here on the right hand side. They have different processes, they're just alive, right? So all the time running over time doing something. And this is what we call parallel processing. So, and of course we want to do this in the best performance way. So we have to think about that we use this time on these processes very efficiently. However, you can imagine that it's not only processing in terms of number crunching of compute. We also have to think about input output. We want to compute something. So data, we want to have data, let's say, saved to disk. So all of this will matter in the course as well. So the IO considerations. Then the question would remain how we measure this really. How do you think we have a high performance computing system? So there are common benchmarks really in the top 500 list, which really lists you the top 500 supercomputers in the world. And basically there are different tools called benchmarks really that not only give you this ranking, so they can basically give you precise numbers in which of the categories, or let's say which of the places the top 500 your computer belongs, but there are also different ones with applications. We will look in this a little bit more in lecture 3, where we see more of the parallelization fundamentals and then also review the performance term a little bit with some theory. But this lecture should be also a little bit practical. So let's see a little bit what this means really when I have an HPC application. Usually you have also scientific visualization that is a very nice way of indicating those. So you would have a parallel application that is, let's say here, having a simulation of the physical process of basically when you can actually create a turbine. You would see over time, this is really changing. Of course, there's a rotation and this gives different stress to material depending on your, let's say, throughput of air. These are all physical processes which needs lots of computing, the interaction with the material, the airflow. So in other words, you have something over time, right? During the time of the simulation, there's something happening. And you see this very nice visualization also on the bottom right here when you have the Eyjafjallajökull, the volcano eruption. And you see basically the aerosols, particles all over Europe that actually at that time, if you remember, have quite an impact in the air flight. So basically, while on the one hand, you use simulations here maybe to get airplanes into the air, right? To let them fly. You see that this simulation probably was more the reason why we put them on the ground and said, don't fly anymore because of the ash and so on. And you will find in many of these areas, in neuroscience, in remote sensing, in basically point clouds of the Earth-Science domain, wherever you go in these simulations, that visualization is a key ingredient really to understand those simulations better. And this can have different types of data to visualize. You see here, you want to maybe have the stream visualized, right? So a kind of constant stream. This is a blood pump to be considered into your into the body. And you want to understand, is there any stress on the blood pump? What is the velocity of the blood? You can have particle simulations where it really matters. And we will have this in one of the lectures also, where we look more deeply what it doesn't mean. But you have, let's say, individual small particles which kind of interact with force fields with each other and influence each other. you would have maybe a traditional, let's say, chopped down grid. Let's say you want to have the coast of Iceland somewhere simulated with, you know, understanding perhaps the fish population better, or essentially the waves and the height of the waves. You would have basically a rectangular grid here, a rectilinear grid that is really almost looking, let's say, chopped down into equal parts. You would have medical simulations where you maybe focus on certain aspects of the body. And all of these are different aspects of how you really calculate this. And we will learn, especially also with this part here of the ocean, because this will be part of one of your assignments, how that really works in practice when you want to now propagate from one tile to another a wave, while the height of the water and the height of the waves of the whole tile is basically computed by the supercomputer. Of course, then chopping everything down in equal parts might not be the best way of using efficiently all the cores. That's why we will learn in later lectures then in aerodynamics, for instance, or computational fluid dynamics, that people have come to much more interesting so-called meshes or unstructured grids, really, where the emphasis and the mesh is much more fine granular when you come close to the object of interest here, the Formula One race car, but also here you see the turbulence coming out of the aircraft, which maybe is interesting to understand the sound and the propagation of sound also, basically with a much more fine-grained grid. Now, coming back to the top 500, which is, of course, important to mention in the HPC course, and you see here on the left, the top nine really out picked out of this top 500, which shares already light on the top supercomputers we have in the world. You see that the Fugaku supercomputer in Japan is, in a way, by far number one. But also you see some certain problem with it, particularly if you think our power considerations in Europe. Then you think about the Green Deal and actually also think about more getting, you know, more green. We see some significant differences between the US systems, which think which also equally in this area. And you see then other systems. The interesting thing is that I already allude to in the prologue, we will come back to this modular supercomputing design, which is a very, let's say, recent cutting edge design, which was developed in Jülich at our site in Germany, where I'm from, since 2004, really, more or less, with having two different parts. One is much more for general purpose computing, one more really for highly scalable codes. And today, this Jewels cluster that you see here at the end is really number one in Europe. So you really see we are cutting edge in this type of design here of how you make not only a powerful supercomputer that you see in being ranked seven. So it really can compute very well, maybe not as good as Fugaku, but it also depends on which applications you run. But more significant is the enormous energy efficiency, if you think what goes along with it. You see here the kilowatts of power, which basically Jewels can achieve. And this is also something I give you the video at the end of this lecture, so we will come back to this briefly. Interesting for you is maybe also the vendors in the top 500. You see Lenovo, which is basically part of IBM from the past, is really driving the most system. And there's a constant change. More and more Cray systems come along. For instance, the Lumi supercomputer in Finland that we will also have in one of the lectures. But also you see Atos in Europe is, let's say, having more and more systems over time. And this really varies. While some vendors maybe at some point really get out of business more and more, and in the past have been very strong in this area. I was alluding, for instance, to the IBM BlueJeans series. Now there are different systems. And if you think about the share in the countries, we basically see not so much changed when we look more into the past. So Japan and China and US always have been very strong in this. And then if you come to Europe, we probably see usually Germany, France, Netherlands, different parts of Germany, of course, different parts of Netherlands, basically being very strong in these systems. But then we will really also talk about less than the top 10. So we will see clearly that China, United States and Japan, they are really powerful. They're large countries. They can really, China and United States at least really can drive a lot in terms of performance. And you will see that with a number of cores here really from the Fugaku, but also from the Summit, which is the largest US system, with 2.4 million cores, right? While we basically are here with 450 cores. It also has to do something with costly GPUs these days, because GPUs give you a lot of performance, but of course, the cutting edge of GPUs are extremely expensive. Now, when we think about how you compute this, there's a Linpack benchmark, which is a little bit in critics around this. So I don't want to speak too much about it. Just let me say that some of the application benchmarks show you much clearly how really the end user application will perform. And this is, of course, one of the critics. While Linpack is a little bit, you know, important part of number crunching with a dense system of linear equations to solve, we see that basically application benchmarks that you have here, Uber benchmark suite, for instance, based on real applications, maybe shows you much more apart from the top 500 placement, how your specific application will perform on this system. And basically, when you now think about the system architecture, we have to think there are some key ingredients. And as you can imagine, CPUs are one of the main part of the architectures. We have seen in the past more multi-core architectures coming out. We see that one CPU with one, let's say, core, and then improve the, let's say, clock rate for the single processor is not really working. It's overheating. And then basically we have lots of errors when you do this. Basically, it reaches so-called limits. So people have started then essentially because of the heat, because of the power limitations, to really think about adding more of these cores on one chip. And this gave us to the multi-core processor area. You see also that this multi-core CPU is really usually leveraging so-called different caches, which are very fast storage, of course, very small storage, not talking about gigabytes or anything, but very close to the core, that's basically having the first idea of getting high performance data into the core, and this on different levels. And there are even, let's say, programs that then can optimize this towards the memory to have cache misses reduced, and so forth. This is one part of the performance optimization we will talk about. So this multi-core chip is very important. And with this, you come a little bit to the dominant architectures of HPC systems, which are often hybrid in basically today, but basically you can always refer to them partly as shared memory computers or distributed memory computers. So how you put it all together, right? More recently, you have, of course, different types of computing with quantum computers, quantum annealers, but also neuromorphic devices. So shared memory computer essentially is driven by the fact that you have a shared memory space, and then you have different threads that can really access the shared memory. So there's a problem of cache coherency in this idea where there are different types. One is a unified memory access, and then a cache coherent non-uniform memory access we will talk about. But essentially you would program all of these in basically the same way. You have a certain standard called OpenMP, and we have a complete lecture 6 talking about it. So where we then have construct to really store something into memory and then retrieve something from memory. When you do so, of course, you want to have maybe a UMA architecture, which means essentially that all of these have, you know, a similar access to memory, right? So all of the processors you see here with the different caches, they can access essentially the memory equally. Some also call them symmetric multiprocessors, which means really a flat memory model. The latency to bandwidth to store to memory to retrieve is quite equal. However, of course, the cache coherency then that could occur is then controlled by this system. When you have now a kind of a CC NUMA system, you basically have a little bit of a distributed setup, although it's not officially, it's basically inherent the design, and you have a so-called coherent link. And in a way, through this link that you have there, you access the memory somewhere else. And you can imagine that you basically then compete with the processors on their own memory. And with this have certainly something where you have to think about the cache coherency much more than in the previous one, where this is of course controlled directly. So there are two different shared memory aspects. It is essentially a logical single address space still, although it's in a way physically distributed, but you are basically lucky that this is all of taken care by this kind of coherent link and also the cache coherency system. And this is shared memory. If you come to distributed memory, which is another important part in essentially the HPC domain, you can imagine that having more and more cores, more computing power, it cannot fit to all one memory. So what we do is, what you see here, you have different processors, they have the caches, and they are connected to their own memory. Now, when you do this in a different scale, and you would say you want to then do more and more of these processors, you can do so. However, the memory is not interconnected. So if this processor wants to have a variable out of this memory, it's not working, right? You have to go through a so-called network interface. You will distribute, or you're required to use distribution of messages in order to really use some form of a network interface to get something from a remote memory. That's why it's distributed. And this brings us to the message passing interface that you're alluding here. Also there, basically having lots of message exchanges between the different processors over time, and something we will also have in lecture 2 and lecture 4 much more in detail. So a specific standard called the message passing interface, which stands the test of time and is still really very much used today. And we will start in the next really lecture 2 and really looking more deeply into this. Now, when you think about combining this, may be smart, you're on the right track. So of course, these systems today, in a way, with a very multi-core rising to more and more cores, we will see that actually you have inherent in all the nodes of a big HPC system, still chips. So these fellows here are still, of course, there, but also now complemented with GPUs, which puts another, let's say, part to it, a host and device. Let's say processor, if you will, and we will see what that materializes and maybe we'll come to later lectures with GPUs. But essentially, you would have different CPUs being in one node, having essentially NUMA or CC NUMA, usually to have this kind of memory access directly within the node. But in order to, let's say, go to data from another nodes on your big system, you will use your network interface in a distributed memory fashion in order to actually get then data out of other nodes. And in a way, this brings us to a very complex way of programming. It's called hybrid systems, where you really have certain patterns to do, where you combine both of these worlds. And this is, of course, not so easy. You will do OpenMP within a node, optimizing there the shared memory. But as you maybe require data from another node, you have to use basically MPI message exchanges to get the data over, and then combine it with your shared memory approach. So in a way, we have here really an extremely complexity that we will allude to when we come to lecture 7. And this is really, let's say, the key basics, if you want. I also brought you a little bit of the idea of seeing what it means to have a supercomputer. We look here now on number one of Europe, which is our Joule system that we have in Jülich. Which is essentially faster than 300,000 modern PCs, even if they all also run on multi-core, you see quite a lot of insights. Also here, you see again on this picture, please have an emphasis when I play this video on this modular idea, because we come in this course again and again to it, basically what that means and why that is useful to do in high performance today. So let's have the video.
Wir können nicht hier so globale Experimente machen. Wir haben nur die eine Erde. Die können wir nicht als Labor benutzen. Aber mit den Simulationen können wir natürlich alles durchspielen.
Unser Supercomputer ist wirklich einzigartig. Wir haben das modulare Konzept zum ersten Mal auf ein System in dieser Leistungsklasse angewandt.
Forschungszentrum Jülich and its partners have built a supercomputer that is setting benchmarks on a global scale. Upon its completion, Joule is the fastest computer in Europe and boasts unparalleled energy efficiency. With its enormous computing power, researchers can accelerate the development of medicines, investigate how the human brain works, and clarify fundamental questions regarding renewable energy and the climate. Crucial to its flexibility is the modular architecture developed at Forschungszentrum Jülich, comprising a cluster and a booster module, which are interconnected. In conventional supercomputers, thousands of identical processing units are combined, Some applications, however, can only make partial use of them. In contrast, a modular architecture works more efficiently. A universally applicable cluster is enhanced by specialized units. For example, an ultra-fast booster, a centralized storage system, or a module for data analytics. And pioneering technologies such as quantum computers and neuromorphic chips can also be directly integrated. The advantage is that each task is performed on the module that is best suited for the task.
Ja, in der Erdsystemmodellierung, da müssen wir unterschiedliche Skalen berücksichtigen. Einmal auf der Globalskala, aber die einzelnen Prozesse, die zum Beispiel für den Klimawandel relevant sind, die haben eine Skala auf Mikrometern und deren Bildung, das sind chemische Reaktionen. Das heißt, die muss man sehr hoch aufgelöst haben. Und hier kommt die modulare Architektur ins Spiel. Das heißt, die besonders rechenintensiven chemischen Reaktionen können wir auf den sehr parallelen Booster auslagern, wohingegen der atmosphärische Transport auf den CPUs im Cluster über die Tausenden von Kilometern simuliert werden kann.
Ermöglicht wird die Modularität nur durch die Software der Firma Partec. Sie erlaubt es, die verschiedenen Rechenaufgaben auf die verschiedenen Module des Systems zu verteilen. In diesen haben wir die schnellsten Grafikkarten der Welt von NVIDIA, das schnellste Rechennetzwerk, das es derzeit gibt, von Mellanox und eine hochinnovative Kühlungstechnologie von Atos. Damit erreichen wir höchste Energieeffizienz bei allerhöchster Performance.
Joules is a modular supercomputer that serves as a model for the supercomputers of the future. With its enormous computing capacity, it is already delivering completely new insights and findings.
Okay, so that's all for this lecture part basically now, and we see us after break.